Hi all, welcome to Smart Catalyst, 29th October 2018. Today we'll be discussing 11 topics, 6 related with prelims and 5 related with mains. In prelims, we'll be discussing the topics pertinent with Rashtriya Vayashri Yojana, Electoral Bond Scheme, States of Poverty that has references from Multidimensional Poverty Index, then about Defense Acquisition Council, then about Amur Falcon. And the last topic would be about the air quality index and the recent high value recorded in Delhi. Let's go to the first topic. It is related with Rashtriya Vayashri Yojana. This Yojana is implemented by the Department of Empowerment of Persons with Disabilities under the Ministry of Social Justice and Empowerment. What is the scheme is aiming at? The scheme is aimed at providing physical aids and assisted living devices for the senior citizens, that is the persons above 60 years, belonging to below poverty line category. While learning about any scheme, it is pertinent to know the category of the scheme. This particular scheme is a central sector scheme and the expenses are borne out by the central government. The cost of implementation would be taken from the Senior Citizens Welfare Fund. Senior Citizens Welfare Fund is a special fund which has the dormant and inactive accounts of EPF and PPF. Amounts from the Senior Citizens Welfare Fund would be used for implementing the scheme. The scheme would help the senior citizens to lead a dignified and productive life with minimal dependence on caregivers or other members of the family. According to Census 2011, 5.2% of Indian population, they have one or other kind of disability. And more than 70% of senior citizens in India, they live in rural areas. These two facts combined gives us the importance of providing dignified and productive life for senior citizens in India. So this scheme is a positive aspect, is a positive way forward in providing a dignified and productive life for the senior citizens in India. The next topic is related with electoral bond scheme. In Association of Democratic Reforms case, Supreme Court had opined that elections are the public expression of discontent over the existing government. So elections, impartial elections and impartial political activity in country becomes more important to maintain the sanctity of democracy. One of the major roadblock in bringing transparency in Indian political system is electoral funding. And in order to curtail the opaqueness in electoral funding, Union government had introduced electoral bond in the budget 2016-17. And what is the nature and character of this electoral bond? Electoral bonds can be brought only by a Indian citizen or a company incorporated in India. And this electoral bond will act as a bearer check, which has a validity period of 15 days. And it is sold in selected branches of SBI only in a specific time window. That is for 10 days during the months of January, April, July and October. And these electoral bonds can be brought in the denomination in the multiples of rupees 1000, 10,000, 1 lakh, 10 lakh and 1 crore. In order to upkeep the confidentiality in the system, the electoral bonds will not carry the names of the donee, and the registered political party which has received the electoral bond, they can encash the bond through their account maintained with banks. These are the features of electoral bonds, and this electoral bonds can be used only to fund the registered political party. So what defines this registered political party? The registered political parties are the parties which are registered under Section 29A of Representation of People Act 1951. And this section of the Representation of People Act mentions that any party that has secured more than 1% of votes polled in last general election to the parliament or any legislative assembly is considered to be a registered party. So only registered party can avail funding from electoral bond scheme. The next article is about the Multidimensional Poverty Index. So who releases the Multidimensional Poverty Index? Multidimensional Poverty Index is released by Oxford University in collaboration with United Nations Development Project. So this infographic states that overall poverty in India has come down, but it has created inequality among the various regions and various communities. Let's see how multidimensional poverty index is calculated. It has a value ranging from 0 to 1. A value closer to 0 indicates low deprivation and closer to 1 indicates high deprivation. Any index calculated by international organization would be based on few important parameters. The broad parameters for MPIR: living standards, education and health. Under living standards, we have 6 sub-parameters. They are fuel, sanitation, water, electricity, housing and assets. Then under education, the sub-parameters are school attendance and years of schooling. Under health, we have sub-parameters of child mortality and nutrition. So this is the basics about multidimensional poverty index. As we mentioned earlier, India's MPI has witnessed regional disparity. Let's see this image. The highly developed states of India, say Kerala, Delhi, Tamil Nadu, they all have value less than 0.06 in the recently concluded MPI. Whereas the BMRO states, that is Bihar, Madhya Pradesh, UP, they have value more than 0.18 or around 0.20. This indicates a regional disparity between the developed and underdeveloped states of India. Also, the disparity is also existing based on community. The disparity is still nearly double among the scheduled tribes while comparing to other communities of the country. So the government should take proactive measures to curtail the gap based on region and based on community in order to bring a equitable and egalitarian society in India. The next article is about the Defence Acquisition Council. This news item appeared in PIB. Defence acquisition in India has been marred with a number of corruption charges. Bofors and a coffin scam during Kargil war. So, in order to counter the corruption and speed up the decision making in bringing in transparency in military procurement, government in 2001 had set up Defence Acquisition Council. So, who is the chairman of the council? Union Defence Minister is heads the Defence Acquisition Council. So, what are the roles and responsibilities of DAC? DAC is responsible to give policy guidelines pertinent with acquisitions based on long-term procurement plans. Working upon this responsibility, DAC has released a 15-year long-term perspective defense acquisition plan. 15-year long-term defense acquisition plan for the period between 2015 to 2030. So this Defense Acquisition Council works on improving the quality of the arms purchased, considering the requirements of armed forces in the terms of capabilities of the equipment, and it helps in optimally utilizing the allocated budgetary resources for defense purchases. So what are the functions of this Defense Acquisition Council? One of the major functions of the Defense Acquisition Council is to provide in principle approval to the 15-year long-term integrated perspective plan for defense forces. Apart from this, they also provide accord of acceptance of necessity to acquisition proposals. They also handle and manage issues relating to single vendor clearance. And in the defense procurement procedure 2016, government had postulated 3 different types of categories. One is buy in India, second is buy and make in India, and the third is make in India. And this DAC has the power, has the responsibility to categorize the acquisition proposal based on the 3 categories mentioned in defense procurement procedure. Under this buy and make category, there is a provision called offset provision by which an Indian company will have technology transfer from a foreign company and would make the defense systems in India. So as far as these offset provisions are concerned, the Defense Acquisition Council has power to decide upon the acquisition proposals which exceed 300 crores. Apart from all these areas which involves in principle approval, categorization based on defense procedure code, finalizing the deal, most importantly, the Defense Acquisition Council has also got an important role to play in field trial evaluation to assess the quality of defense system to be procured. The next article is about the migration of Amur Falcons and how the arrival of Amur Falcons in a village in the border of Assam, Meghalaya has cut down the border dispute between the states. The news item speaks about a political dispute, but as far as we are concerned, Amur Falcon is important for us. So what is an Amur falcon? Amur falcon is a raptor bird. What is a raptor? Raptor species includes eagles, vulture, and other birds which swoop down to attack their prey. Amur falcon is one of the most important raptor species. And where does it breed? It breeds along the southeast Russia and northern China. And this area indicates the temperate grasslands of Asia. These Amur falcons feed on the organisms present in the temperate grasslands. And during the winter time, the climatic condition in this region becomes inhospitable. So they undertake migration, and during the migration they travel west through India and across the Arabian Sea to the eastern part of African continent. En route to their breeding places, they feed on dragonflies, and they follow a similar migration path over Arabian Sea for a long period. This Amur falcon is known as the longest seafaring bird, and it travels 22,000 kilometers to complete the process of migration. CMS, the Convention of Migratory Species, has classified the different parts of the continent based on the migration patterns followed by the birds. And this Amur falcon falls under East Asian Australasian Flyway and African Eurasian Flyway. This map indicates the migration route of Amur falcon. What is the IUCN status of Amur falcon? The IUCN status of Amur falcon is least concern. It indicates they are high in number. This Amur falcons, they are facing threats from anthropomorphic actions. First, the Amur falcons are trapped for their meat. This over harvesting for meat is posing a threat to the Amur falcon's existence. Amur falcons thrive on the organisms living in grasslands, that is steppes of Russia and Mongolia. Due to anthropomorphic actions, there is a degradation of grasslands, and because of this, Amur falcons are losing their habitat. Important agreement related to raptor species are Raptor MOU, signed under the auspices of Convention of Migratory Species, which is also known as Bonn Convention. This CMS is under the ambit of United Nations Environment Program, and it is aiming to conserve migratory species throughout their flying range. The CMS has a MOU, which is known as Raptor MOU, in order to protect the flyways of migratory species along Africa and Eurasia. We discussed what raptor species are. Raptor species are more important as they play the role of scavengers, and among the avian ecosystem, they occupy top of the pyramid. This Raptor MOU is not legally binding. This was concluded during October 2008 and it has come to effect in November 2008. India has acceded to the MOU, Raptor MOU, on March 2016. The next article is related to the high value of AQI registered in Delhi. Delhi has witnessed an average value of 366 even before the starting of winter, which is a grave sign of concern. The topic was about pollution in Delhi, but they have mentioned about air quality index. In 2016 prelims, there was a question on the different constituents of air quality index. Since it has been coming in the news again and again, it is pertinent to know the different constituents of the air quality index and the categorization of air quality index. What are the different constituents that make the air quality index? It is calculated based on a 24 hours assessment of particulate matter 10, particulate matter 2.5, nitrogen dioxide, ozone, carbon monoxide, sulfur dioxide, ammonia and lead. Based on the different levels of these pollutants, the various data collated from the level of these 8 pollutants, AQI value is calculated, and it is classified into 6 types. They are good, satisfactory, moderately polluted, poor, very poor and severe. And every category has associated health impacts. AQI value under good category has minimal impact for human health. Under satisfactory category may cause minor breathing discomfort to people who are sensitive to pollution. The equivalue under the moderately polluted tag might cause breathing discomfort to the people with lung diseases, asthma, heart disease, and for children and older people. If the AQA value is under the poor tag, it causes breathing discomfort to people on prolonged exposure and discomfort to people with heart disease. Under very poor tag, it has pronounced effect on people with lungs and heart diseases. Under severe value of AQI, the people will experience high health impacts even during light physical activity. So, the AQI has become an important indicator to identify the quantum of pollution in India. In order to provide information about the level of pollution in Delhi, the government under the Ministry of Earth Sciences has introduced a new app called Suffer. This Suffer was developed by Indian Institute of Tropical Meteorology and it is operationalized by Indian Meteorological Department. It monitors all weather parameters like temperature, rainfall, humidity, wind speed and wind direction and displays these vital informations in an LED board. Let's move to the topic that is pertinent with mains. We'll be discussing 5 articles. The first one is about India-Japan cooperation and relationship. The second is about the protection of RBI's independence. Third is about a pass we are facing in India's reform agenda. The fourth is about the importance of Asia-Europe cooperation in the wake of a recently concluded ASEM summit. And the last one is about depreciating rupee. Let's move to the first article. The next article is titled Gulf in Strategic Precepts. It appeared in The Hindu. This article speaks about existing dimensions between India-Japan relationship. So, India and Japan had started summit-level interactions from the year 2006. And in the year 2014, this relationship got elevated into a special strategic and global partnership. India and Japan, located along the Indo-Pacific region, they value each other very well. And with the ascent of assertive China in the region, the cooperation between India and Japan becomes more imperative. There have been a few areas in which these Japan and India are coordinating and cooperating together. One of them is development assistance in India and in some other third country. In India, Japan has invested in many of infrastructural development projects. And one of the most important project is the recently proposed high-speed rail project, which is also known as bullet train between Mumbai and Ahmedabad. Apart from this, Japan has also proposed, has also invested in many of these dedicated industrial corridors, be it Chennai-Bangalore industrial corridor or be it Delhi-Mumbai industrial corridor. Japan's role in India's infrastructural development has been inevitable during the past 2 decades. Also, in economic front, India and Japan, they are implementing the Comprehensive Economic Partnership and Agreement, which is CEPA. Because of this, trade facilitation is made easy and the duties on few selected goods have been reduced to boost the bilateral trade between India and Japan. Apart from these developmental initiatives in India and economic trade related partnership, India and Japan have also discussed about providing infrastructural assistance and developmental assistance to third world countries like the countries present in Africa. This idea is propagated through the proposal of Asia-Africa Growth Corridor. But the relationship between India and Japan is horizontally widening, having presence in different areas, trade, development, assistance. But the sad point is that the vertical depth in these areas are very less. That is, there is no extensive relationship between these two countries in terms of trade, in terms of defense procurement, or in terms of financial assistance or development assistance to third world countries. Under the trade parameter, the bilateral trade is very bleak, the potential is very high, but the actualization of the potential is very less. The trade hasn't even touched the 20 billion mark between those two countries. In Myanmar, both India and Japan have proposed to create more developmental infrastructure, but not even a single project has taken off in this Myanmar and Mekong region of Southeast Asia. Also, the largest gap in potential versus reality is widely evident in the areas of defense cooperation. India and Japan has been discussing about the purchase of US-2 amphibian aircraft for the past decade. This has not materialized till. So, defense cooperation is lagging. The author has suggested few important measures to improve the depth in India-Japan foreign relations. So, what are they? The author has suggested that there is a mismatch between the notions of cooperative security in Asia between India and Japan. India has always conspicuously committed to a non-Western pluralistic model of cooperative security in Asia. But whereas in the case of Japan, right from the time of Meiji Restoration, which happened 150 years ago, they are unable to provide a solution thinking beyond European or Western-led alliance. So, India believes in non-Western model of governing security in Asia. Japan has been unable to go beyond Western-led alliances in providing security in Asia. Now it's time for both countries to think about the possibilities, joining hands together to provide security and strategic equilibrium in the Indo-Pacific region. The next article is about the conflict between central government and RBI. The article is titled Protecting the Central Bank's Independence. This article appeared in newspaper Mint. During recent times, we have witnessed conflicts between popularly elected government and the constitutionally mandated central banks of the respective countries. For example, consider the case of American President Donald Trump's criticisms over US Federal Reserve. Also, the recent incidents in Turkey indicates what could be the detrimental effect of conflict between government and central bank. Turkey's currency had depreciated 70% owing to the domination of government over the central bank's policy. So the author has suggested that India should learn lessons from the incidents that has happened in Turkey. Even RBI's deputy governor Viral Acharya has openly spoke about loss of RBI's autonomy due to government's intervention. So, what is the case for premises for conflict between RBI and the central government? Any popularly elected government, in order to have electoral gains, looks for short-term targets, and long-term perspective of the economy is completely left away. But the role of central bank, that is RBI, is to build a sustainable growth, which is clearly evident from the statement of RBI deputy governor that RBI is playing a test match, whereas the government wants to play a 2020 match. That is, the government always looks for a short-term targets, whereas RBI looks for a long-term targets based on sustainability. Also, there was a controversy, there was an open statement provided by RBI Governor Urjit Patel that RBI lacks control over public sector banks, which was also widely criticized by many eminent economists as a fault in the side of government. The central banks should have institutional powers to take independent decisions in order to maintain price and financial stability, because the central bank is the one which is going to issue and manage currency of a country. So they should have independent powers in order to maintain sustainable and long-term evolving economy in the country. So one of the major areas in which RBI is criticized is related with the flexible inflation targeting framework followed by RBI. But the author is arguing that this flexible inflation targeting framework would strengthen the macroeconomic stability by cutting down or keeping the inflation at bay, and keeping inflation at 4% would lower the borrowing cost for the individuals, through which the economic growth in the country would be initiated. The author has also suggested that if the monetary Policy Committee manages to keep the inflation around 4% mark, this is going to significantly benefit the economy. The present government or the past government have taken some of important measures to improve the functioning of RBI, which is evident from the outstanding governors, be it Raghuram Rajan or be it Urjit Patel. The governments have appointed outstanding governors to improve the functioning of RBI. Also, the present government had the political will to pass the legislation to form a monetary policy committee. These two means are commended by the author. The author has also given few ways to move forward. The first one is that the government should not force RBI to take decisions which favors the political gains, political objectives of the government. Also, improve the second point is related to improved transparency in RBI's decision making. The RBI's position should be deliberated to the public transparently. And the third is assertion of RBI's independence. The author suggests that RBI needs to assert its independence whenever required and wherever possible. The next article is related with the past experience in India's reform agenda. So the article suggests that between 2014 to 2018, the government was able to introduce many structural reforms in the Indian economy, which was made possible by the political stability or political majority of the ruling party and the reduced oil prices, which was around $60 per barrel. But with elections approaching and with oil prices approaching above $90 per barrel, the space for reforms has become very narrow for the government. So this is the important reason for which the structural reforms have become stalled in India recently. What are structural reforms? Structural reforms are essentially the measures or the initiative taken by the government in order to change the fabric of economy and the regulatory and institutional framework in a country through which the businesses and people operate in the country. What are the recent structural reforms introduced by the government? The first one is the bankruptcy law. It changed the fabric of the country, which was plagued with Chakravyuha challenge, as mentioned by Economic Survey. And in order to improve the institutional framework in improvising health services to the people, the government has introduced Ayushman Bharat. The author has criticized that the Ayushman Bharat scheme is underfunded, but it is a move in right direction to provide universal health care to the citizens of India. So the author has suggested that the present state of governance in India needs significant structural reforms. The legislative productivity in India has come down, and the last budget session of Indian Parliament is considered to be the least productive of all budget sessions that happened in independent India. So with legislative productivity coming down, which has great impact on structural reforms happening in the country, no significant bills have been introduced in the areas of agriculture or labor have been passed and has become an act. The author has delineated the different reforms needed in different sectors. The first one is in agriculture sector. So there is a disproportionate relationship between the population dependent on agriculture and share of GDP of agriculture. So the author has suggested that there should be an reformative measure which should involve in bridging the gap between the population involved in agriculture and the GDP share of agriculture. He has suggested that land fragmentation, sustainable use of technology, drip irrigation, cropping methods are the important areas in which the government focus should be directed on. The second area is about job creation. The employment elasticity of India has come down. Now it's around 0.2 pertaining to the GDP growth. Even we have a great potential to improve in our tourism and infrastructure sector, which has great potential for job creation and also for economic development, which has not witnessed any realization of potential. So the author has suggested about setting up a cross-disciplinary cabinet task force which would work on job creation in different sectors. In human capital index, India stood 115th out of 157 countries. So human capital specialization, which involves skill development and entrepreneurship, should be developed in order to create jobs for millions of Indians
in employable age.
The next reform the author has recommended is pertaining to the labor market. The author mentions that the government should enact the recently proposed labor codes in order to improve the labor market transparency, in order to improve the employability for employers. The next reform is related with the public sector banks. The government should take measures to resolve the NPAs and to improve the governance of public sector banks in order to avoid the PNB like fraud happening in other public sector banks. Also, the author has mentioned about the reforms in the areas of female empowerment. The recently released Global Gender Gap Index of World Economic Forum, India had slipped 21 ranks from 87th rank in 2017 to 108th rank in 2018. The author has suggested that making female participation, female labor participation equivalent to China would lead to rise of prosperity in India. The author has suggested even other reforms in the areas of judicial capacity, police reforms in ease of doing business, reforms related to reservations for marginalized communities, reform of electricity distribution companies. To conclude with, the present trend growth rate of India is around 6.5%. India has the potential to increase the 6.5% to 8%, which needs action. Mere sloganeering alone will not help to increase the growth rate of India. Every 1% increase in trend growth rate has potential to lift 25 million households out of poverty, which is too crucial to improve and to establish an egalitarian India. The next article is related with the recently concluded Asia-Europe meeting. So what is ASEM, Asia-Europe meeting? It was established as a dialogue forum with 26 partners in 1996, mainly aiming to bridge Asia and Europe. Now, in 2018, it has increased to from 26 members, the organization has grown to 53 members, which includes 51 member countries and two regional organizations, ASEAN and European Union. This Asia-Europe meeting represents 62.3% of world's population, 57% of global GDP, and most importantly, 60% of global trade. These factors indicate the potential of ASEM. India became a member of ASEM in 2007. The recently concluded meeting was based on the theme Europe and Asia, Global Partners for Global Challenges. I repeat, the theme for this ASEM meeting was Global Partners for Global Challenges. In this meeting, they had four areas of discussion. The areas of discussion were trade and investment, connectivity, sustainable development and climate, security challenges. The security challenges include terrorism, non-proliferation, and chemical weapons. Though the organization was founded in 1996, it has gained importance in 2018 because of ongoing shifts in global power and geoeconomics. Different variables have been introduced into the equation, into the function of a global equilibrium. The variables are deal-breaking tendency of Trump and other geopolitical tensions like civil war in Syria, Katsa, conflict between China and USA. ASEM having consisting four United Nations Security Council members, all BRICS members except South Africa, and it has 12 of 20 G20 countries, has important role to bring back the equilibrium in the global order. European Union has been the major contributor for FDI inflows for ASEAN, India and China. Apart from this, and it is also a major trade and investment partner for ASEAN, India and China. With the Brexit looming around for European Union, Asian relationship becomes important for European Union in terms of trade and security. Already, the countries like France and Germany have started to involve in security matrix of Asian countries. European Union has always been an important trade partner for India, and the future holds new vistas for cooperation between India and European Union. ASEAN countries should find common ground on trade liberalization and reduction of tariff and non-tariff barriers in order to streamline the trade and commerce between the countries. One of the areas of major importance between Asia and Europe is connectivity. We all know that Asia and Europe is connected through land, and various countries have taken various measures to use this land-based transportation to improve the trade and commerce in the region. India's INSTC, China's BRI are examples for connectivity projects between Asia and Europe. The importance of connectivity between Asia and Europe is visible through the European Union Commission's recently published report. The policy document suggests that the connectivity would have importance on fostering physical, economic, digital and people-to-people connectivity between Asia and Europe. Also, deliberations at the ASEAN conference were aimed at providing sustainable, comprehensive and rules-based connectivity to enhance prosperity, safety and resilience of people and societies in Europe and Asia. The trade between Asia and Europe is not a new phenomenon. It has been happening for ages. The old Silk Route between China and Europe is a better example for the indicates the longevity of age-long relationship between Asia and Europe as far as trade matters are concerned. The author has recommended that ASEAN is too important to create a rule-based, transparent multilateral cooperation mechanism which has potential to yield quality investments for greater intra-regional, regional and inter-regional connectivity. The next article is related with depreciating rupee, which has provided no room for exporters to improve their exports. This article appeared in The Hindu. So normally, any student of macroeconomy would know that whenever the currency of a country is depreciating, the exports would increase. But in the case of India, which has been witnessing depreciating rupee for the past 3-4 months, the results are contrary. Even with depreciating rupee, the exports of Indian goods have not increased, which is also evident from widening CAD of India. Pressure groups like Federation of Indian Export Organization have given few reasons which has caused the tanking of exports in India even with depreciating rupee. What are those reasons? The first reason is high input cost. The cost of raw material, either from the domestic source or imported, has increased in the period, because of which the export costs have also increased, which has cut down the export potential of India, and tariff uncertainty. And the second and third reasons are closely linked. The present world trade order is witnessing mockery of rule-based regime, by which the leaders of developed economies, through their whims and fancy, change the tariffs. This has caused tariff uncertainty. One of the major point of trade between India and US is through this generalized system of preferences. With this GSP in play, India enjoyed duty-free exports to USA. But there is a confusion surrounding the India's eligibility for this GSP, which has got impact on realizing the export potential of India even when there is a depreciating rupee. And the last and most important reason is related with delayed refund under integrated GST. The exporters have to comply with the integrated GST norms, and the government has promised refund under integrated GST. This IGST refund is basically given in a form of duty scrips, which can be used for duty drawbacks and delayed refunding has got impact on export potential of the industries. So these are the reasons that has pulled back the growth of India's export, which should have normally grown in the situation of a depreciating rupee.